It's the Cool Kids Club. You've been invited to the Cool Kids Club. It's so exciting, yeah. Justin likes monsters, yeah. And Amy likes words in the Cool Kids Club. Cool Kids Club!
Hey, everyone, and welcome back to the Cool Kids Club. This is episode 54 here at the Cool Kids Club. And I am one of your hosts, Amy.
Hi there, EB. I'm Justin.
I'm Billy D. Williams.
I'm Billy D. Williams. It was very, very smooth, very rich sound
very
tonight.
Very smooth, very rich.
Like a Colt 45.
That's right. Well, it's going to be a good one, guys.
Oh, boy.
We are feeling... Now, we have both eaten dinner, so we have that going
yes.
for us. But
I have
it
some
is
food on my
work.
Stomach for this one.
We do. We're not totally delirious, but I feel like we're going to get punchy.
Mm-hmm.
Just with the sheer, it's the end of the day.
It's the end of the day, and it's this topic.
And it's this topic, exactly. Now, Justin, what are we talking about today on the podcast?
Well, I feel like you should introduce it, because this is an Amy request. This is an Amy idea. We're talking 90s pop princesses. We haven't done a whole lot of
yes.
music episodes.
We have not.
We did do the Spice Girls, which
mm-hmm.
which was another
which is
hot Amy pick.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it was my birthday pick last year.
And we did Weird Al.
We did Weird Al, yes.
But now we're doing 90s teen pop princesses. And so I feel like this is kind of... Would you say this is the Mount Rushmore of 90s
Ooh,
teen pop
yes.
princesses?
It is. It is. And I want to say that, you know, there were so many people in the game at this time.
So many players in the game?
So many players in the game making incredible pop music as solo artists. And I want to recognize that. Because I don't want to be like, these are the only four people making... But clearly they were not. They're not. You know, J-Lo was starting around this time. You had Pink. You had Kelly Clarkson a little bit after this. I mean, you had a lot of...
You are in your element. I can already tell. You are in your element.
I'm very
excited for this.
Well, and you know, Mariah Carey had already been around for years. Brandy had been doing her thing. Of course, Beyonce breaks away from Destiny's Child. So, like, there are clearly female pop artists out there doing the damn thing. But we are specifically talking about this phenomenon of these four little white blonde girls that were, like, in the year of our Lord, 1999... It was like all four of these record labels, which I think is Epic, Jive, RCA, and Columbia. They all had this teen pop princess that they were trying to push. And it was all in response to Britney Spears, who was the OG. And so that's what we're talking about today. So I want to recognize that like a lot of people were doing... You know, a lot of women were...
Recognize.
You know, yeah. Like, I want to, you know, be clear. Like, there were a lot of people doing amazing stuff right now. But this was just, like, the year 1999 was so saturated with, like, this one type of bubblegum pop. And
well, and I feel like
everybody wanted
this is
to have
its own kind of piece of the larger puzzle that was like
yes.
90 like pop music at the time, because it was you had
yes.
the boy bands and then you
yes.
had these teen pop princesses
exactly
that, and then you had like pop
teen.
Punk stuff too
yes
you know that kind
yes.
of like almost like subgenres, but it was all sort of the TRL
yeah.
the TRL stuff
yes. And you know, specifically, you did in the later, you know, the latter half of the 90s, you had the boy group or the girl group was so big. And so all of these, you know, producers and stuff, they were trying to find the next group. They were trying to find individuals that they could put into a group. And aside from Destiny's Child, which they had been working and doing their thing for most of the 90s, but didn't get popular until the end. in the U.S., you really didn't have a girl group that was huge, like you did the Spice Girls in the U.K. You know, you had Backstreet Boys and NSYNC, which were enormous, but you didn't have the girl group. And in fact, when Britney Spears was starting out, she was being eyed for a girl group, and they didn't want to sign her as a solo act because they were like, it's not about solo acts right now, it's just about groups. Like, we're just trying to do groups.
Just groups.
And Jive Records ended up taking a chance on her and was like, she's that good, we're just going to sign her as a solo artist. And that is really when this particular, we'll say kind of competition almost among these four women, whether they were doing that or not, certainly the media was, and their record.
I'll tell you what. I'm just not nearly as plugged into this as I guess I thought I was, because the fact that this is even a thing with a narrative of a competition is like, I just kind of I kind of got to know who they are.
Yeah, well, and I guess because I was a very impressionable girl in 1999, I was 12 years old. I can remember every one of these people like coming onto the scene. And then you look back and,
well, like, oh, as a 14-year-old boy, I remember also.
Well, sure you do remember. But when you look back, you're like, oh my God, it was all in 1999. Like, they all basically, the four of them all had their first songs in 1999.
Okay.
Basically. Baby One More Time.
This was the sound of the new millennium.
And it was. It absolutely was. It's like this post-millennial pop.
It's the Willennium.
It is. It was. This is the Willennium. This is the sound.
The Willennium that was prophesied.
That was promised to us. That's exactly right. But we're kind of getting ahead of ourselves.
We're not at the Willennium yet.
We're not at the millennium yet.
Who the fuck are we even talking about? Because you've said Britney Spears, but I said Mount Rushmore. That's four people. Britney Spears, unless I'm mistaken, is just one people.
She is just one person. She's not the Olsen twins. Which, as we
you
know,
mean there's
from
not
Rock, is four people. There's not two. Where's four? It doesn't roll off the it's not the same.
Cut that.
No, we're talking about four different individuals. We have Britney Spears, we have Christina Aguilera, we have Jessica Simpson, and we have Mandy Moore.
Okay.
Now, you are familiar with all these people, correct?
Sure, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
I mean, familiar enough. I know who we're talking about.
Oh, yeah, you know who we're talking about. Okay. Could you name a song by each one of those artists?
I don't think I could name a Jessica Simpson song, but I could name songs for the others.
That's probably for the best. Yeah. Now, I have our episode today. We've talked before, I don't usually do the research on the episodes. That's usually Justin's game, and I do all the post-production editing. But for this episode,
that was your glimpse behind the scenes of the Cool Kids Club.
Yeah, well, we've talked about that before.
Yeah, let's talk about it some more.
Yeah. But today, I've done the research for this as well, because it's a lot, and it's very specific to, like, my interests and not exactly Justin's.
So I'm going to get schooled today.
So Justin's going to get schooled today. Yeah. So I thought about, how do I want to structure this episode? And I thought about, you know, kind of starting out with maybe the lesser popular of the four, working up to the most popular. But then I thought, let's kind of go in chronological order of who hit the scene first.
Let's.
So, you know, we're going to give you just a little tiny bit of background on each one. But really, it's going to be more about, like, the years. I kind of focused on the years 99 to about 2003, 2004.
That's about the time frame that our podcast.
But you were in high school.
Well, that's about. I feel like that's where my nostalgia stops.
Well, yeah.
You know.
Well, for me, I graduated high school in 2005.
Uh-huh.
So I have a lot of. It's up to 2005 is a very specific. But then I have nostalgia for things, you know, later 2000. which was like my college years. But stuff we're talking about on this podcast, I would say, is anything from 2005 and then before. But yeah, that is about the work that was happening specifically by some of these artists between the years 99 to 2004 is just unreal, really.
It's shocking.
And it's all happening. It's shocking. And it's all happening, you know, at the same time, because whether, you know, whether Britney, Christina, Jessica, and Mandy wanted to, they were pitted against each other by record labels and the media. And it was very much like this kind of unspoken competition. And everybody wanted to know, like, oh, do they like each other? Do they hate each other? And all that kind of stuff.
Drama.
Just simply because they were all very much the same look, very much the same.
They were doing the same thing. They were trying to do this. They were competing for the same audience.
Exactly. And we got to start with Britney because she's the OG. She is the OG. Now, you had... Did you have a Britney Spears poster in your room, Justin?
Oh, yeah, probably at one point. I think I did. I had this CD.
You did have her first CD.
I don't remember buying it, but someone... Not that I'm opposed to buying it, but I don't recall buying it.
No, I feel like that was a gift from... I feel like you maybe had the Pepsi promotional poster.
There might have been a couple at one point. I don't know.
Britney Spears was...
You can trace the lineage of my development into a man by several Britney Spears moments.
And we're gonna talk about some.
The first one, of course, being, the "Hit Me Baby One More Time" video.
And as the kids say, it was a cultural reset. And
do the kids really say that?
Have you never heard that?
No, well, I'm not a kid. I'm not a kid.
They say that about everything.
Right. Okay, yeah.
Everything. But this truly
was. It means
was.
Nothing.
It means nothing except for when I'm talking about the Hit Me Baby One More Time release in December of 1998 and the subsequent video. Because it really was. It ushered in the millennium. It was like, oh shit.
It was the harbinger of the millennium, if you will.
It was basically like, we're approaching the last year of this millennium.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going out with a bang.
Yeah.
This
was everywhere.
I could not escape the song in this video. No. I cannot overstate what a hit this was. Like, what a gigantic... It was just beyond.
Whether you loved it or hated it, everybody had an opinion on it. Everybody was aware of it. Everybody knew all the words. Everybody had seen the video and it was talking about the video.
And had an opinion about the video.
Yeah.
Exactly.
It really was massive. Like, yeah.
It was.
This did feel like a big cultural moment. Like,
in retrospect. It absolutely was. Yeah. So just to give a little bit of background, I think most of us are very familiar with Britney Spears, maybe some more than others, but, you know, she is giving me Let's talk about It's a Bop. It's a Bop. I don't want to hear anybody.
Oh, it's a great pop song.
It is a great pop song. Obviously, like some other people on this list, Britney Spears grew up, you know, singing and trying to kind of bust into that career. She was a
Was she trying Mickey to bust Mouse a move? Club.
She was trying to bust. She busted a lot of moves on the Mickey Mouse Club.
Yeah, they all did.
Yeah. In 1990, Disney Channel wanted to do an all-new Mickey Mouse Club. And Britney Spears auditioned for this in 1990. I think she was like 9. And they were like, we really like you, but you're too young. And so she kind of goes, she starts doing commercials, you know, singing her national anthems, going to county fairs, doing the whole thing. And then in 92, they're like, they contact her and they're like, hey, would you want to audition again? Because you're old enough now. And so she auditions and she gets it. And that is the same year, of course, that Christina Aguilera, Justin Timberlake, Ryan Gosling, and Keri Russell are also cast on the Mickey Mouse Club.
Damn.
So, I know. Quite the lineup. Quite the lineup. And then Mickey Mouse Club gets canceled a couple years later. Britney goes back home to Mississippi. She goes to private school for a couple years, still kind of trying to do her singing thing. And then skeevy old Lou Pearlman. You familiar with Lou Pearlman? Do you remember?
Yeah, I remember. I know this guy. Yeah. I feel like he was the subject of a lot of VH1 documentaries.
yes. He's the guy that formed the Backstreet Boys, NSYNC, O-Town, several others.
Wasn't he a like a legit creep?
Yeah, he was a legit creep. And he ended up going to jail for tax. He was doing a bunch of shady shit.
He's dead now, isn't he?
I think he might be. I could be wrong, but I think he might be.
I'm gonna look up Lou.
Yeah, let's live Google Lou Pearlman
dead.
His Wikipedia picture is one of his mugshots, which is great.
My caps lock was on, so I just Googled. I just screamed Lou Pearlman dead into Google. Yes, he is dead.
Is Lou Pearlman dead? Where is Wishbone buried?
I just typed Wishbone.
Wishbone.
Where are you buried? Yeah. Anyway, Google told me Lou Pearlman's dead.
Lou Pearlman is dead.
I just great. Thank the you, mic Google. A lot.
Well, old dead Lou Pearlman, back when he was alive.
back when he was alive. Kicking.
And creeping, he was eyeing Britney Spears probably in more ways than one for a girl group called Innocence.
Lecherous.
Innocence. Just want to be clear on that.
Okay.
Because of course, like I said before, everybody was trying to do groups. It was all about the girl groups and the boy groups. And she'd been, of course, sending her demos. Jive Records decided, like I said, to sign her as a solo act in 1997. And so all through like 98, they've got her on like a mall tour opening for NSYNC. Remember mall tours?
Oh yeah.
I remember it was called like the L'Oreal something professional mall tour. It was great. And then
those
the song,
were the days.
I know, man. The song Hit Me Baby One More Time came out in December of 98, and the album of the same name came out in January of 99. So, truly a cultural reset. This is still the biggest selling album of any teenage solo artist.
Wow.
Yeah. It went 2-time platinum in the first month of being released. Like you said, I mean, it was just everywhere. It was huge. And this is really what started everything, because you have these other girls. You have Christina, Jessica, and Mandy, who have been working on music separately in like 1998, 97, 98. And then Britney Spears is the first to come out with anything. And then everybody's like, oh, shit, we got to get their stuff out. Yeah, we got to get our own cute little blonde girl, you know, singing sexy songs at 17. Like, we got to get our own, you know. So, Baby One More Time, huge hit. And then you have, I think Christina ends up being the next to come out with a single, which was, of course, Genie in a Bottle. And that one was in May.
Yeah, I remember this being like the 1-2, like 1-2 punch of like the first time I'd heard of either of them.
Yeah.
Were those two songs.
Now, who do you like more? Britney or Christina? As a 14-year-old boy.
I mean I was a Britney guy.
Yeah.
And I think I'm a Britney man.
Yeah, yeah. I'm with you on that. Britney had that.
Despite dirty era Christina Aguilera.
Oh, God, it's so dirty, though. It's dirty. Like, it made Tara Reid look classy. You know what I'm saying? Like, it was like, oof, duh. Like,
We'll get there.
We'll go to each person, but you have Britney come out with a single in January, Christina in May, I think Mandy Moore is August, Jessica Simpson September. So in this 9-month span, you have these four artists debut their singles and their albums, and it's just full teen pop mania in 1999.
Woohoo!
So now that we kind of have like the stage set, oh my god, did you like that? We had the stage set.
I loved it.
now that we have the stage set, we know what 1999 looks like. We're gonna kind of
frosted
talk
tips.
A lot of frosted tips, a lot of chunky highlights. Mm-hmm. For Christina, you had the black and then the bleach blonde. Like, that was the dirty era. It was a lot. A lot of highlights just all around for everyone.
Sure.
If you were brunette, just you may as well just been dog shit. Like, in this era, it was all about blonde. And now Britney Spears had kind of a blondish brown hair when she first started, but very quickly became blonder and blonder, and you know. So now we're just going to kind of talk about each one of these for the next like couple years during like the height of their popularity. So
are the kids these days nostalgic for this? Because I know like Y2K stuff is very nostalgic with like Gen Z. Are they? Uh-huh. Is there like a revival of like this type? Or like, are people like going back and dressing like Britney? Or
I think that definitely. Well, I don't think that Britney Spears as a cultural, we'll say icon, has ever really gone away.
Sure.
She's always been, for better or for worse, in the public eye. Even, you know, during her conservatorship, I mean, she was working constantly. She was making albums all the time. She had a Vegas show. She had, you know, I mean, she's never not been a household name. Christina Aguilera and Mandy Moore, I mean, they all are still relevant and they're all doing their own things. I think that if I'm online, I think I see mostly nostalgia for like early Britney. I don't see as much for the others. I don't think anyone cares much about Jessica Simpson's singing career. Except for maybe Jessica Simpson's dad, which I think is the one that cared the most about it. To begin with. So yeah, I mean, I think that I definitely see like I work with high schoolers and I'll see them like wearing Britney Spears shirts.
Okay.
So I do think there's definitely like, I think she might be the only one.
We're at Hit Me Baby One More Time nostalgia here in a year or two.
Uh-huh.
We'll hit Oops, I Did It Again nostalgia.
Oops, I Did It Again nostalgia. Correct.
Speaking of Oops, I Did
man,
It
those
Again.
Those albums. Yeah. So she has, you know, 99, she hits, well, really 98 when she starts promoting the first album. You also have, off that first album, you have You Drive Me Crazy, which then corresponded with the movie with Melissa Joan Hart, You Drive Me Crazy. And it was like the theme song for the movie. And then,
I love when you're in your element like this. It's fun. Just be like,
it's just
the Britney Spears Melissa Joan Hart crossover, yay!
Then Britney Spears shows up on an episode of I think it's a premiere of Sabrina, not a finale.
Oh, okay.
It's one of them. Like when that movie, because like Melissa Joan Hart, basically that movie comes out like I think over the summer in between the seasons, and then Britney Spears as Britney Spears has like a quick cameo in a scene. In an episode of Sabrina the Teenage Witch. Lots of fun. The video for that song has Melissa Joan Hart in it. And of course, like, she's actually in the video. And then there's also clips from the movie. Another good one. And then right off the heels of that, you have Oops, I Did It Again. They were like, we've got to capitalize on this shit. And so that comes out in May of 2000. The millennium has begun.
Right. She is ushered in the millennium.
Yes. Debuts at number one, breaks the record for the highest debut sales of any solo artist.
Damn.
I mean, it's just crazy. This one, of course, had Oops, I Did It Again, Lucky, Stronger. Those were some of the singles from that. It's nominated, doesn't win, but it's nominated for Best Pop Vocal Album at the 2001 Grammys. It's a big deal. And this is also the year she performs at the MTV Music Video Awards.
Is this the one with the snake?
No, we'll get to that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, we'll get to that. She has quite a few MTV Music Video Award performances that are iconic.
Yeah, remember those manhood milestones I mentioned? Several of them are from the VMAs.
This is one of them. So the 2000 VMAs, she does the performance where she's wearing like a black suit, and then she tears it off and she has like a sequined flesh-colored bodysuit and does like a huge dance number. And this was sort of like
Bodysuit Man, like when George Costanza wore the bodysuit and streaked to get fired.
Yeah, exactly.
It's just as sexy.
So, just as sexy. This is, the media was like, oh, this is her, you know, she's shedding her girl next door, you know, because she's, and I mean, really, I mean, as if she wasn't a sex symbol before that. I mean, she was literally wearing a schoolgirl's outfit.
Yeah.
You know, the Hit Me Baby One More Time video, but... and this is the year that she confirms that she is indeed dating NSYNC frontman Justin Timberlake.
Oh, now there's real life romance.
Real life romance. She's, of course, known him for a long time. They were on Mickey Mouse Club together. And yeah, she has confirmed that they are dating. NSYNC is hotter than ever. Britney Spears is hotter than ever.
Amy is living her best life.
I am living my best
9/11 life. 9/11 hasn't happened yet. This world was still good.
Things with the millennium.
The millennium was on fire.
It was on fire. I think that it's the next year at the VMAs that they wear the iconic denim look.
And that's when everything started going downhill.
And that with is the that matching was denim the outfits. Beginning of the end for the whole world.
Next thing you know, 9/11.
That's right. Exactly. So 2001, another big year.
Okay.
She comes out with her third studio album, just entitled Britney. She hosts the AMAs. She performs with Aerosmith and NSYNC at the Super Bowl halftime show.
Yeah, I remember that.
This is where she signs her multi-million-dollar deal with Pepsi.
Oh yeah, the Pepsi commercials.
So this is the album, Justin, with I'm a Slave for You, which is where she does this is the, slave dare I say, most, I keep saying iconic, but it's true. This is, I feel like this was like peak Britney.
Yeah, probably.
Is this performance at the VMAs with the giant albino python.
Is this 2001?
Tigers. This is 2001 VMAs. Yeah. And even though the album Britney is her first not to produce a top 10 hit, like I'm a Slave for You was the best performing single on that album, but it was not as successful as her other ones. But then she comes back in 2003 with In the Zone, which has Toxic.
Now,
and so she's kind of like,
that was always,
that might be her best song.
That was always my favorite.
That might be her best. She's got a lot of hits, and even after this, she's got a lot of great songs. Toxic might be her best song.
Yeah, I mean, it's my favorite. It's my favorite song of hers for sure.
It's such a bop. So that is this performance was 2001. Okay.
Yeah, this is peak Britney. This is
peak Britney. Yeah. 2002, Forbes ranks her the most powerful celebrity. Her movie Crossroads comes out, which I've actually never seen.
What?
But I feel like I know.
How have you never seen that? I've never seen it, but
I don't know.
That's to be expected.
That makes sense, though. Yeah, exactly.
That's crazy.
Yeah. I don't know. I'm sure Jesse and I will watch it sometime soon.
You will watch it.
I've been listening.
Right now, and then we'll come back to do this. We'll finish this later. I will wait.
All right. She also opens her first restaurant, Nyla, in New York City, and then closes it. Okay. And then she and Justin Timberlake break up. Because again, it's all downhill.
Yeah, we've peaked.
Yeah,
we've peaked with the Python.
And then she announces she's taking a 6-month break from her career in 2002. But at the end of the year, she does start working on her next album, which is In the Zone, which does have Toxic. This is the VMAs with Christina and Madonna and The Kiss.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
That's also on your... I feel like you have like a timeline. You remember they used to make us do the timelines in school? Uh-huh. Justin's is just Britney VMA performance.
Well, it's not just that, but yeah, they're on there. There's a bunch of them.
They are heavily featured.
Yeah.
There are a few. People lost their shit over this.
Oh, yes. Yes.
I mean,
this was like when before like the idea of something going viral was really a thing. This is before YouTube, you know, and it was just like, I mean, that's as close to, I would say, as going viral as you could get in the year 2003.
Oh, I mean,
we just didn't have that terminology for it.
We didn't. I feel like it's so funny now because you're like, oh my God, three women and they kissed on television. And now I'm like, we have Euphoria. Like, what?
Right.
Like, I'm just like, three women kissing on TV. That's just Tuesday, but in 2003, it was a big deal.
It blew everyone's skirts up, didn't it?
Yeah, it really did. this is where she has the collab with Madonna. She does Me Against the Music on this album, and obviously the most popular song is Toxic. And this was, you know, just a continuation of her just kind of like doing her thing, being just an excellent dancer, because she is. She's an excellent dancer. You know, we can talk about it, all of their sort of vocal chops and who was the best, Christina, who was the overall best, Britney. I mean, you know, we can talk about these things, but Britney is an incredible dancer. And I know that, you know, she posts her crazy Instagram videos now and she's just spinning around, but she's a really talented dancer. And this was really, these couple years here is really her, like, in her element, like these VMA performances and stuff.
Yeah.
It is really peak Britney.
Oh, for sure. And honestly, this is the last time I have a memory of like going that first semester of college and Toxic was big. And I feel like that was like the last time I was keeping up with like Britney Spears. Like with that, familiar enough with pop music, I guess, to like keep up.
Yeah.
But then, like, I mean, she kind of, that was when she started having her problems. That was after that, right?
Yeah. Yes, it was shortly after that she gets married to that guy she grew up with. They're married. They're married for like a day, and then she marries Kevin Federline.
I was going to say there was the Kevin Federline era.
She starts having a couple kids. 2007 is when she
K-Fed, if you will.
2007 or 2008 is when she has her like public breakdown. So yeah, really after this is you start. There's kind of a slow decline into that. But that's when she gets married and becomes a mother. And so you know, she does slow down making music. Not much, but she does. Yeah. And then, of course, you know, we won't get into everything else, but the conservatorship and, you know, all that stuff.
Yep.
But this is, like, peak Britney in this moment, and this is when this whole like pop princesses, who's the best of the best, was such a big deal. And I think that really, you know, we have the four, but when you look at it, like when you break it down, it was really always Britney versus Christina.
You know, it was funny that you say that, because it is those two. And I always, and it's a very Justin thing to put this in wrestling terminology. I'm aware of that, but it makes me think of that, how, like, if you think about, like, certain eras of, like WWF, WWE, there's always a 1A and a 1B. It's like, if, you know, like, there's, like, two clear top people, but one of them's just, like, a little bit like the person.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's yeah. like Hulk Hogan's your 1A, Randy Savage is your 1B.
Exactly.
You know, or yeah. like, you know, yeah. John Cena's your 1A, Randy Orton's your 1B. Like,
right.
they're both the, at yeah. that level, but one's kind of the the undisputed king or queen.
Right. And I think that, you know, despite our personal favorites, because, I tend to prefer, well, we'll get into that later. But I guess despite personal favorites, like, you have to kind of, you can't deny that I feel like Britney Spears is, like, has the title of pop princess. But not for, she had a lot of competition. And Christina Aguilera, you know, came up in very similar,
she's the one, she's the 1B parallels to Britney's 1A. She's the 1B.
They both competed in Star Search back in the day. Mm-hmm. They both, of course, were on the Mickey Mouse Club at the exact same time. Christina Aguilera, though, she grew up in New York City. She moved around a little bit. She was in Japan because her dad was in the military. She ends up in Pennsylvania. And then, you know, in something when I was doing research for this, I had absolutely no idea that after Mickey Mouse Club was canceled, you know, I said Britney Spears, she went back home and she went to private school for a few years. Christina Aguilera, around the same time in 97, moves to Japan, which she had lived there as a little kid for a couple years. She moves to Japan and tries to do, like, music there, which I had never, I never knew that. I
didn't know that either.
And she has a duet with a Japanese artist named Kaizo Nakanishi, which is called All I Want to Do, but there, it didn't really go anywhere. And so she's, like, continuously, like, sending demos out to everybody. And she, of course, sends them to Disney, who she has, you know, a relationship with from doing Mickey Mouse Club. And they choose her to sing Reflection, which is the theme for Mulan, the 1998
anime. I've never seen Mulan.
It is very good. And now I think that it's, like, in the movie, the whoever's voicing Mulan sings the song. But then I think for, like, the soundtrack and probably, like, during the credits, it's Christina Aguilera doing it.
Okay.
And so that actually led to her getting signed with RCA, was her doing that song for Mulan, which I totally didn't even know.
I had
no idea that she had, like, gone to Japan, done any of that.
No, Genie in a Bottle was the first time I think I heard of her.
Yeah.
Well, like, yeah, probably absolutely. Most people, I would say.
Yeah, I would say. So yeah, she signs on with RCA, much in the same way. They're all kind of working on music in 1998. Mm-hmm. And then Britney Spears releases Baby One More Time. RCA is like, shit, we got to get her stuff ready to go. And Genie in a Bottle comes out in May. And it is very clearly their attempt at matching Britney Spears' popularity.
Right.
And I mean, it is also a really big hit. I mean, it's not Baby One More Time level, but it is huge. Yeah. It was a very big hit for her.
Your 1A and your 1B.
It wasn't
a cultural, exactly. Whatever you said.
Cultural reset. No. It was not a cultural reset, because Britney had already reset the culture.
Yeah.
You know, she'd already done it.
She'd already begun the doomsday clock to the millennium.
That's true.
With Hit Me Baby One More Time.
Yep. Now, Christina Aguilera does have an incredible voice.
Yeah, I mean,
you kind of can't deny that.
Yeah, she's the best singer of them, right?
She is absolutely the best singer of them. Yes, she has a 4-octave range. I mean, girl can sing.
Sure.
You know, you may not like her style necessarily, but, like, she's got some pipes, and they're all, you know, they're, well, not so much Jessica Simpson. They're all good singers.
Sure.
But Christina Aguilera, I mean, she wipes the floor with him as far as singing. But of course, just like Hit Me Baby One More Time, Genie in a Bottle is very suggestive. It's very sexual. I think she's 17, 18 when it comes out, so of course everybody's got something to say.
A lot of midriffs. A lot of midriffs in these music videos. A lot of navels.
Uh-huh. I mean, you gotta rub me the right way. Mm-hmm. It's like, You know, it's very suggestive. This one also has, she comes out with her self-titled album, which of course has Genie in a Bottle. What a Girl Wants, another good one.
That was a big one.
That was the big one. My personal favorite, Come On Over, Come On Over, Baby. Come on over.
Now see, I
come on over. Come
I'm mostly familiar with that song baby. Because whenever like one of my cats is walking towards me, especially yes. like walking across the couch towards me, I'll sing. Yes. Come on over, uh-huh. kitty.
Exactly. So, yes. Yeah. So Christina is influencing your everyday life.
I mean, I can't deny that. Yeah.
Yeah. When I hear that song, I think of how. You come over here, baby. And that video, and they're all wearing white, and she's got like red. She had already started, I guess, with the hair. She had like the bleach blonde, super straight hair, but then like the underside of it was red. It was just, oh God. Yeah. But anyway, I think of how I took a dance class, which I know that's funny because if you've ever known me, I took a dance class. I took a dance class funny with if my you've best ever friend. Ever met Jessie. Amy. Yeah. After my sophomore year of high school, and we did a, at the Parents Award Day, we did a dance routine to this song in front of
In front of God and everybody.
In front of God and everybody. I did that, and I can't.
Is there a video of this, do you think, somewhere?
I don't know, probably somewhere. Not that we have. I'm sure somebody's parent somewhere took video of it. And that is why
my high school reunion's coming up. I'll ask around.
Oh, Jesus. I can't be the absolute. And then the year later, I sang a Billy Joel song at the talent show. What kind of balls did I have on me in high school? Justin.
Doesn't sound like you at and all. Not,
Justin, not one of the hits. Like a deep cut.
A deep cut Billy Joel song.
Not like Uptown Girl.
What's Billy Joel song was
not,
it?
Not Vienna.
Oh, okay.
because it was on the 13 Going on 30 soundtrack, and I was obsessed with it.
So here's a request that I'm going to make live on the air. I'm assuming that throughout this episode, you are going to plug in some clips of some of the bigger songs we're talking about, yes?
Oh, sure.
Well, go ahead and plug Vienna in right here.
Come on, Zover's babies.
Come on, Zover's babies.
Slow down, you crazy child. You're so ambitious for a juvenile. But then if you're so smart, tell me why are you still so afraid?
And our hits, and our Hit Me Babies. And you just
our Hit Me, all our babies.
Hit Me's baby.
Get loopy.
We've only talked about two of the four. Two? Gotta move it.
Gotta get scooting.
Yeah, just drop me some Vienna in there.
Okay, yeah, I'll give everyone just a taste. Yeah, this the balls.
Yeah,
I had.
Yeah, weird.
It's very weird. It's very weird.
I played Dave Matthews Band Tripping Billies and sang it in front of everybody at probably the same talent show, so I don't have any room to talk.
That's true. Billies. Just one more really embarrassing thing that I did before.
Let's do this
we
now.
Get on to
until we get dirty.
Yeah, we're about to get real dirty with three R's.
Arty.
In eighth grade, we had to, memorize a poem, any poem, we could just pick a poem, and we had to recite it to the class, and I was like, can I do a song?
Oh, yeah, I did that too. God, ugh.
And, my teacher's like, well, sure, like, it's lyrics, and I'm like, can I sing it?
Amy!
Amy. What's that Dave Matthews Band song? hang on.
Okay, so I did the thing where I asked if I could do a song instead of a poem, but I didn't sing the song. I just recited it.
Let me look it up.
Well, no, it's... I'll know what Dave Matthews Band song it is if you describe it. Trust me. I'll know it.
I have his entire discography memorized.
I mean, up to a certain point.
It was on one of those earlier EPs. It's the I'll Remember...
I'll back you up.
Do you remember her?
I'll back you up.
Thank you. It's I'll back you up.
See, I told you I'd know it.
Justin,
you sang that in front of the class?
A cappella. Justin, what was wrong with me?
And
here's the thing, I did not have confidence. So I don't know what the fuck I thought I was doing.
To myself? I was torturing myself.
I just thought, you know what? What is there to lose? Absolutely nothing. I don't have anything. I don't have any clout. I'm not cool. I think about those like situations, and I'm just like, I want to crawl under a desk for me.
Uh-huh.
I just thought, why not? Oh, and same class.
I'll just eat some trash.
Same class, did a multimedia project later in the year about John Lennon, did the entire project as John Lennon in a terrible British accent.
Now that I remember, because I remember you dressed as John Lennon.
Yeah. I do not have a good British accent.
Stop, Charlie!
Uh-huh. I'm sorry, we have taken a turn, but I just really feel like you all needed to know that.
We are way off topic. Jesus.
All right, cut that, sorry.
Cut that.
I'm not cutting that, because I don't want to go over it again. you all know that now. These are my deepest, darkest.
Hey, Amy, okay.
Let's get dirty. Now, you're getting just a little ahead of yourself. Oh, before we get dirty,
we got to get the
we have a collaboration.
Get sticky.
We got to get the marble get sticky, and then we get dirty.
Sticky and dirty.
We get all sticky icky, and then we roll around some.
Now,
dirty
Lady Marmalade. Dirty. Yeah, that was another milestone. That video.
Now that is a quadruple threat.
It is.
Of Christina, Lil Kim, Pink, and Maya, ooh. And then you also have Missy Elliott. I know.
She dropped off the face of the earth.
I feel like she's like the most normal of all those. Well, she probably was like, what the hell are these bitches doing? And then just like peaced out. And then of course you had Missy Elliott. Because why wouldn't you?
I'm never gonna complain when Missy shows up.
I'm never, never. The addition of Missy only makes things better.
Correct.
This was a Grammy winner for Best Pop Collaboration with vocals.
This was a huge hit.
Oh my God.
It wasn't a cultural reset, but it was a huge hit.
It was huge. And it was, of course, on Moulin Rouge soundtrack. And talk about just a movie that helped form my identity was Moulin Rouge. I was obsessed. This was a big, big hit for her. Then this is kind of the start of the dirty era, though, because she's
getting a little dirty in that video.
She's already getting a little dirty. She's got a little.
It's just dirty with one R, though, right now.
Yes. And then you flash forward the next year, and she's added two more R's on
there. Two more R's?
Two? Her new album and her new look. She's got new management. She's got a new look. Her jeans are lower than ever.
Yeah.
Her jeans are so... I don't know how we don't see her labia. I mean, I looked at pictures today just to really put myself back there, and I'm just like, Christina.
Sometimes I look at pictures to put myself back there, too.
Yeah, I bet you do.
Hey-o!
It's unreal. She has the longest torso I've ever seen in my life. Probably because most of it is... She's also got the fupa part. It's just so long.
Uh-huh.
Her jeans are so low. And She's got that nasty-ass hair that's half black and half
now, this is X-Tina, right? Like,
this is X...
Degeneration X?
Degeneration X. You're exactly right. X-Tina. This is kind of... It wasn't like a full-on alter ego, but this was like, this is the new era. It's X-Tina.
It was her evolution. It was the evolution of the millennium.
It was. Well, 9/11 happened, and we all changed.
9/11 happened, and the next thing you know, Britney Spears is taking time off, and, and Christina is now dirty.
Is X-Tina, and now she's dirty. We changed us all.
All because of the denim at the VMAs that year.
They tempted fate with that denim, and
now we all pay the price.
Now we all pay the price. Yeah. So this is before she's about to take a break. Okay. Next year, she is. This is the dirty era. The album is called Stripped. New management, new look, new everything. I gotta say though, the singles. I mean, Dirty is a bop.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful is this, you know, ballad. It's really good. She's got great range. Fighter's one of her best songs. So she's got a lot of good singles off this album. And then of course, 2003, we catch back up. We have the MTV Music Awards, the VMAs, the infamous performance with Britney and Madonna.
Yep.
So, and then we kind of come back around. So this is like your two hottest pop acts in the world with like the first,
maybe and not they, the first and it was almost the end star, of an era because we quit talking
it about really this was.
Initial era of Britney around 2003, 2004. Here we are at the end again with the two biggest plus the biggest pop star of the previous generation up on stage together, right? And that kind of feels like end of an era.
And it kind of was. Their careers change
after that.
They really do, yeah. And Christina takes time off. When she comes back, I think it's 05 or 06, she's got a whole different look. She's got the, like, Marilyn Monroe, Ain't No Other Man, kind of like 40s USO kind of look. It's completely different.
Yeah.
She takes some time off from there. So, yeah, it really is. This is kind of like you're go for several years, and then... You hit the pinnacle,
as we saw with the Spice Girls, it's like you can only do that for so long before everything starts falling apart. You can only keep that grind up for so long
before Jerry leaves and ruins everything. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Thanks a lot, Jerry. Thanks a lot, Ging.
Thanks a lot. Now, obviously, Britney and Christina are probably the heaviest hitters, but we still have Mandy Moore and Jessica Simpson. And while their careers ended up taking different paths, you know, they're still popular today for their own things. They still have their own things going on. But I think they didn't stick in the game for as long as far as like, trying to continue to be the pop princess,
I think they they did more like crossover stuff. Like they didn't stay as more like music. Because like when I think of Jessica Simpson, I'm like, she had her singing career, but then she tried to do acting and all that other stuff.
She had a reality show.
And the reality show, yeah. Mandy Moore. I don't think of as, maybe because she was younger and wasn't like as, I don't know, sexualized as the other three.
She wasn't, yeah.
It's kind of like, I mean, she kind of made that successful transition to like acting and stuff too, right?
She did. And she's really the only one of the four. I mean, she's, even though she has continued to make music for years, she's most known as an actress. Mm-hmm. And I mean, obviously she was most recently on This Is Us, which was a huge hit. She transitioned into acting early, you know, right after I think that first album came out. And even though she continued to do music for a little while, she started focusing more on acting, and like you said, what made that successful transition, and is really the only one that did.
So you asked me toward the beginning of this episode, like, could I name a song by all four of these, and I said I probably couldn't name a Jessica Simpson song, but I can name many Christina Aguilera and Britney Spears songs. I could probably only name you one Mandy Moore song. I could name it, but it would be only one.
And what?
Well, that'd be Candy.
Well, wouldn't it be?
Yes.
Love Always.
Randy. My main talking point about Mandy Moore on this episode is the joke about replacing the word candy in that song with the word Randy. And how much funnier,
now,
how
that,
much
is funnier a Jamie that makes joke, it. Correct?
That is a Jamie.
A Jamie original. Our good friend
Love
Jamie,
Always.
Who
Randy.
I know listens. Yeah. You know, when she does the spoken, where she's reading the letter in the middle of the song, and she says, Love Always, Mandy. And yeah, Jamie replaced it with Randy, and we still say it. It's 20-something years later. Because it does make it so much funnier.
Now, this was a good pop song. This was really catchy.
Candy's a great pop song. And Justin, I rewatched the video for it today, and I was like, holy shit. It is the most 1999 thing. I was like, oh my god, it's like opening a Delia's catalog. Like, it was literally, it starts out, she's in her room, she's alternating between like three different outfits and looks. One of them, she's got her hair in these like kind of low buns with the chopsticks in them, and like a long slip skirt and spaghetti strap tank tops with a Walkman on, and then the one she's got like the really straight sleek hair with the choppy layers in the front and like tight cargo pants and a tank top. I mean, and then her and her friends get in a green Beetle, and like a 2000 Beetle, and I was like, Jesus Christ, this is everything that middle school Amy wished.
Yeah, I was just about to say,
I was just like,
this was your best you.
This was my best. She was living my best life. Yeah. No, Mandy Moore was never, I feel like, never sexualized in the same way. And I think part of that is her doing, you know, and I think part of it is that I feel like she has a relatively normal family. And I hate to say that, but like, I don't think the others really did. It's particularly Britney Spears and Jessica Simpson, but, you know, she just had a kind of a very normal family, and I think they were there to protect her from anything happening. So she wasn't super over sexualized, and she was the youngest. She was like 15 when her first album came out, which of course was in 1999. She ended up, her family lived in Orlando, and so she did lots of like local productions. Like, she did acting and voice lessons. She was always like into both of them. And then she gets discovered. Now, I read this on her Wikipedia, so I don't know if it's true, but she was working on some music by herself. She had booked some time at a studio, and someone overheard her. A FedEx delivery man overheard her, and he had a friend at Epic Records, and he was like, I think he needs to hear you. And Epic Records listened to her demo and signed her. Now, whether that's true or not, I don't know. And then they start working on her debut album. She also toured and opened for NSYNC and Backstreet Boys. And then she had the... I can't remember if her and Jessica Simpson one had the latest album release of the year. But I know Candy came out in August. A couple months after Genie in a Bottle. But she really did, like, she was very much a part of MTV at this time. She, like, kind of worked as a VJ. I don't know if you remember that. And, like...
Gosh, not really.
Had her own talk show called Mandy. And, of course, because she was coming out, she was doing this bubblegum pop. She was white. She had blonde hair. She was young. She was immediately compared to Britney and Christina, just based on that alone. Even though she kind of got out of that fairly quickly and really didn't continue on with that, but I think she just by nature of it, she just was compared to
that. I think, yeah, because I honestly couldn't name you a song other than Candy, and I just don't think of her music career as lasting that long.
Which is strange, because, like, she has got tons of albums, but they're just not this pop music. You know, they're not like that. And in fact, some of my favorite stuff from Mandy Moore is years later.
Yeah.
And it's not this at all. Of course, I mean, I love this, and this is what it is. But it doesn't sound like this. So she comes out with an album in 1999 called So Real. This has Candy on it. It has her other big hit, Walk Me Home. And then they do a weird thing. Like, this comes out late 99, and then it didn't have great reviews. And so the record label, like, remixed it, did, like, a slightly different track list, added some new songs, and then they reissued it in May of 2000 as I Want to Be With You, which was another one of her songs.
Okay.
And so it's, like, not a true follow-up, but it's considered her second album. It's kind of weird.
Oh, that is weird.
And internationally, it's considered her first album because they never released So Real internationally. Okay. So, yeah. So, you almost immediately, though, you have... like, in 2001, she starts acting, like, with regularity. She comes out with, I guess, technically her third album, which is just called Mandy Moore. And that one is not as pop sounding. Mm-hmm. She was kind of already, like, over that. She was sort of like, no, I want to have, like, live instruments.
I want to be a serious artiste.
Yes. Like, she wanted to be, like, a singer-songwriter.
I want to hone my craft.
Yes. So this one had, like, Crush, which you've probably heard. That had Cry.
Sounds familiar.
Which you've probably also heard. And this is the year that she stars in The Princess Diaries with Anne Hathaway.
Which I've never seen.
What?
I've never seen Princess Diaries.
Justin, that's like one of my favorite... That's like a desert island movie.
Oh, okay.
That's one of my absolute favorite
movies. Well, if you want to show it to me sometime, I'll watch it. But you have to watch something in return.
Okay. Find me a good double feature that'll go with Princess Diaries.
All right, I'll think on it.
And then, even though she does keep making music, the next year we have A Walk to Remember. And, Justin, I cannot express to you enough how important this movie was to me in 2002.
I saw A Walk to Remember in the theater with a girl.
Well, same, but not in the same context, I'm sure. I saw it with my friends Whitney and Adelia.
Oh, yeah.
That's what I remember. So you were on a date? To see A Walk to Remember?
Yes, I was. Yeah.
Did the girl you were with, did she cry?
I think so. Yeah.
Did you cry?
No.
You held it together.
Yeah, I you know,
stiff upper lip.
Stiff upper lip. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Was it a first date?
Oh gosh, maybe it might have been.
You can tell me after the episode who it was with.
Sure. Yeah.
We won't put anyone on blast. Yeah, this, I've seen this movie so many times. I have just a very, I just came out at the right time for me, I guess. It is ridiculous. It's obviously, it's based on a Nicholas Sparks novel. Over the top, cheesy, over the top, dramatic and sad, just like all Nicholas Sparks things.
Mm-hmm.
But
emotion,
my God.
Porn.
Emotion porn. Yeah. And she dyes her hair dark brown, and you're like, oh, she's serious now.
That's how you know. She's an artiste. She's an artiste. You know. She's willingly going brunette.
She's an artiste now. Exactly. She's ditched the blonde. She's going brunette. And this movie has... She sings in this movie. And so she has her third single, Cry, off of that self-titled album. She kind of she puts out to promote the movie. I think it's in the movie. And then there's another song called Only Hope that's in the movie that I just absolutely love. So I lay my head back down and I lift my hands and pray to be only yours. I pray to be only yours. I know now you're my only hope. It's just all I need the Walk to Remember girlies to come to. We need to talk about it. We just need to talk about it. It's so cheesy. It's one of those movies I've seen probably 60 times, and I could just, like, I know every beat of it.
We could do a movie club on it. It's pre-2005. It counts.
Have you watched it since theaters?
I want to say I maybe saw it one other time, but it's been a long time. Like, I probably saw it again within the first few years of it being out, like at someone's house or something. But
yeah,
but that's it.
Yeah. Now, I've gotten to the point where I don't really cry anymore when I watch it.
Oh,
but,
good.
Because it is. It's incredibly cheesy. But I love it. And it just... You got to think, I was 15 when this movie came out. It just was... Oh, it was perfect. It was perfect. I digress. So, anyway, Mandy Moore continue. You know, she's part of this whole teen pop princess, but I feel like she's in it the shortest period of time.
Sure.
I feel like 99, 2000... And then by the time she comes, that's pretty much it. She starts acting in 2001. She starts doing music that's like, it's pop, but not in the same way. Yeah. Not pop adjacent.
It's not I'm a Slave for You.
No. Yeah, like Britney just gets harder into the pop. Christina harder into the pop.
Yeah.
But Mandy Moore, not really. And frankly, I like Mandy Moore the best.
Is she your favorite?
Not as a teen pop princess. Mm-hmm. I just really like Mandy Moore. I've always liked Mandy Moore. She seems like a real nice lady. I like her. I think she's cute. She's a cutie pie. I like her acting. I like her music. Yeah, she has seemed like the most down to earth, relatable of all of them.
Oh, yeah. Certainly. Yeah.
Yeah. The most in touch with reality.
Speaking of down to earth and relatable. tell me about Jessica Simpson.
It may be clear already in this episode that she's not my favorite. I don't dislike Jessica Simpson necessarily. I don't feel much towards her.
I don't really have whole lot of Jessica Simpson opinions, if I'm being honest.
Yeah, me either. She was kind of similarly to Britney Spears, she grew up in Texas, grew up in like a conservative Christian household, sang in church growing up. Her dad was like her manager and he was always weirdly involved, and he like gave her a purity ring when she was 12, and they made like a big deal about her, like, she publicly, I don't know if you remember any of this, but she like publicly came out and was like, I'm waiting until marriage.
Yeah, I kind of remember that.
It was just kind of like,
strange.
Why are we even talking about that? Like, that's, you're 17. Why? You know, like, it just was weird. Yeah,
that is weird.
And it's Tommy Mottola, who I don't know if you're familiar with him. He was married to Mariah Carey. He discovered Mariah Carey and then married her and groomed her and was her manager. He kind of, quote, discovered Jessica Simpson and signed her to Columbia Records. And she was their answer to Britney and Christina, of course. And so her debut album is called Sweet Kisses. And it comes out in 99, of course. Her first song, her first big hit was I Wanna Love You Forever. I don't know if you remember that one.
Not really, no.
No? Okay. Well, I did such a good rendition.
I know.
I'm
assuming you did.
Yeah, I think. Yeah. And then the I Think I'm In Love With You, which samples that John Mellencamp song.
Oh, okay. I remember that one.
Yeah.
Jack and Diane.
Baby, I'm in love with you. Yeah. Yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Ew. I don't hate that song. I mean, it's stupid, but it's a good pop song.
I don't really like Jack and Diane.
Well, I don't like John Mellencamp. I don't like John Cougar. I don't like John Mellencamp. I don't like John Cougar Mellencamp.
Any combination of John Cougar and Mellencamp.
Any combination of those things, don't like. I don't like him. I don't like him. Like, sometimes it'll come on the radio and I'm just like, I don't fucking like this song. I don't like him. I don't like any of his songs. I mean, it's nothing personal. I don't know anything about him, but I don't enjoy his music. I think we probably lost a lot of John Cougar diehard cool kids.
That was such a big demo for us.
I'm sure it was. The Venn diagram of people that listen to this podcast who are huge
Mellencamp disdain comes from the same place of hate that your disdain for the song Life is a Highway comes from.
Justin, as soon as it starts, I get aggressive. So goddamn angry. I get aggressive. I'm like, I'm going to drive the car right off the road. I hate the song Life is a Highway. I can hate it so much.
But I digress.
And Justin loves that I hate it.
I really don't
anyway,
love it.
No, that you love that I hate
oh,
it.
Oh, I do love that you hate it, yes.
Yeah, I don't know what you think. It's hysterical, but... So Jessica Simpson, I feel like, you know, they really tried. They tried to push her. Now, she is not a good singer. I'm sorry to say it. She mostly just does that. She's very like very breathy and very. And it's so funny because I feel like they wanted to push her as like this anti-sex symbol. And I'm like, she might be the like.
She's the one singing
sexiest
the sultriest
of them all. She's the one singing the sultriest, and I feel like I'm like, I don't. Maybe it's unfair to her because like she has big boobs, but I feel like she was like the most sex pop of them all. Which is, I don't know if it was because of the whole like virginity thing. Maybe it was like that dichotomy. I don't know. But I mean, I think of her mostly. I guess as with Nick Lachey, and
honestly, yeah, the first thing I think of is like the reality show stuff.
Yeah, even though I didn't watch it, that's still what I think.
Oh, also, where we've been watching a lot of that '70s show, she's on that. She's on a couple episodes.
She
of that.
Is now. She's actually pretty funny.
Yeah, she's not a great actress though.
Well, no, but I mean, she's playing. Basically herself. She's playing like a dumb blonde bimbo, which I don't know how much of that is an act with her. I'm sure some of it's an act. Some of it she just leaned into. But I have to say, the whole is this chicken or fish?
Debacle, yeah.
I have to say, as someone who has been known to say some really dumb shit out loud because they didn't think it through... Mm-hmm.
Like washing the tomatoes the other night.
Justin said, "Cut these tomatoes and wash them." And in my head, it had to be in that order. And what he meant was like rinse that tomato off and then cut it. So I cut it up and I said, "You want me to wash these slices?" And he was like, "Well, before you cut like the
soap them up. Don't you know how to cook?"
It's kind of like the Abraham Lincoln Jeopardy question.
Yeah.
What president died of pneumonia?
It was not Abraham Lincoln.
And I screamed out Abraham Lincoln because I just heard what president died and my brain stopped there.
Since none of the other presidents have died.
they're all alive to this day. I get it. I get where something like that, and I feel bad because I feel
like
that just
defined her. We're talking about the chicken and fish thing again, right?
We're talking about the chicken and fish. Jessica Simpson, very famously on her reality show, Newlyweds, Nick and Jessica, is eating chicken of the sea tuna. We all know the story. And she is eating it, and she turns to Nick and she goes, "Is this chicken or tuna or fish?" And he's like, "What are you talking about?" And she's like, "Well, it's tuna, but the can says chicken of the sea. So is this chicken or fish?" And he just like looks at her and everybody's like, "What an idiot." And I'm like, and then she like figures it out. And I'm kind of like, yeah, been there. said something really dumb before, not thinking it through, and then just been like, oh god, that was so stupid, of course. So I kind of feel bad, because I feel like she just got
because
a bad
you've
rap
done, you do stuff
abs-
like that.
Because I also an idiot.
I also big dumb.
I also big dumb dumb. So, yeah, I mean, however, and I know we're getting a little ahead of ourselves. Jessica Simpson didn't have a great, she didn't have a great musical career. Her second album, Irresistible, came out in 2001. That was pretty much the only hit off of it, was Irresistible. She gets engaged to Nick Lachey in 2002, gets married that year. They have a reality show, Newlyweds Nick and Jessica, which starts the next year. And then she has another album come out that same year. But really, after that, she doesn't have... I mean, yeah, she does continue to make music. But that's really not what she's famous for. Like, at any point in time after 2003, really. So, doesn't have a huge, like, long-lasting... I feel like she keeps trying to compete with Britney
Yeah,
Christina.
Honestly, like, what is she... I haven't seen Jessica Simpson in years. Like, what does she do nowadays? Like, I mean, honestly, like, you've got Dukes of Hazzard here, and that's probably the last thing I remember of her. I mean,
well,
did she make
well,
music?
Well, she started
I, well,
making
she went country.
Edible...
She went country, I think.
She did country for a little bit. Well, she's like a wife and a mom now, and I think she mostly... I mean, she has like a line of... She has like a fashion line and like shoes and clothes and... kind of like entrepreneur, kind of does stuff like that, and it's just like a mom. She did just have a memoir come out like 2 years ago called Open Book, and our friend Katie read it and said it was excellent, and she really trash talks John Mayer a lot in that, which I would not mind reading.
Okay.
So I kind of am intrigued and kind of want to read it, because I do think that she's not as dumb as like media made her, you know, seem, or even that she made herself seem. But I do want to, the Nick and Jessica Variety Hour was a 2004 TV special. I wonder how Nick Lachey feels about all this now. It was like a 1 hour thing. And they had several people on. There is a performance with Jewel, who comes on and does her hit song, Who Will Save Your Soul, with Jessica Simpson.
Now, you recommended that I watch this. Because obviously I'd never seen this before. You recommended before we recorded that I watch this, which I did.
Mm-hmm. Tell me your thoughts on that.
It was a lot to take in.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. It was a lot to process. They try to hustle, I'm trying to bust them, try to cuss them. And the cops want someone to bust down on Orleans Avenue. Another day, another dollar, another war, another tower went up. Where the homeless had their homes. So it rain us, man, a different gods as their flowers. But we call religion our friend. We're so worried about saving our souls, afraid that God will take his toll, that we forget to begin. But who will save your soul when it comes to the clouds? Who you will save your soul after all those lies you told? What was happening here?
I don't know. You know how Jewel sort of has, like, that way about her with the singing? Jessica Simpson, she took that, and then she just cranked it up to 11, and she added her own Jessica Simpson-ness to it.
Uh-huh.
I don't know that most of it was real words coming out. It was just another
man, man, man. I was listening to the when I first listened to it, I thought, Who Will Save Your Soul by Jewel? Oh, yeah, that's a good song. And then I was listening to it. I was like, have I always been wrong about this being a good song? Like, does this song suck? Is this what the song has always sounded like? And I'm just now realizing that it sucks?
No, not really.
Not really.
It is something I think of almost every day.
I don't know how you've never shown it to me before.
I don't know how I have it either, but it is really, truly something
else.
Do you
think Jewel was just mortified?
I actually... Oh my God. I feel like there's definitely parts in that performance where she's thinking, what in the fuck are you doing to my song? I wrote this song in a van. Has Jewel ever
spoken about it that you're aware of?
Down by the river. Not that I'm aware of. Be curious to know. Jewel, you know, Jewel really takes a turn towards the pop around this time as well.
That's true.
Yeah. Not a successful one.
No.
Yeah, much like Jessica Simpson's movie career. She is cast as Daisy Duke in the big screen adaptation of Dukes of Hazzard. Probably her biggest role, considering her other role is Employee of the Month with Dane Cook. She really didn't have a lot of starring roles, probably because she's not a great actress. Like, I'm shitting on her a lot. I'm sure she's really good at a lot of other things, but unfortunately, singing and acting are not two of them.
Yeah.
Yeah. She does do a pretty bad cover of These Boots Are Made for Walking for the Dukes of Hazzard soundtrack. Yeah. So, I feel like, you know, you even though Jessica Simpson did continue on with music and stuff, that you do get at least around 2002, 2003, where she kind of splits off and starts doing the reality TV thing and very much like, you know, did stuff for MTV and things like that. Whereas Britney and Christina just kind of kept on
being pop stars.
Yeah. Yeah. And then Mandy Moore again goes off and kind of is more of an actress first and then a singer second. So that is the four teen pop princesses of the late 90s, early 2000s.
Definitely big influences on Amy.
Very big influences on me.
This is a big deal for you.
It really was. I mean, you could not... Between the four of them, there was always one of their hits on the radio. There was always one of their music videos on when you're getting ready in the morning. Mm-hmm. Like, they were just, for those 3 or 4 years there, I mean, there was one of them all the time. And, you know, there are Jessica Simpson songs that I like, you know, even though she's probably my least favorite of the four. Like, there's still ones that I like. I like With You. I like I Want to Love You Forever. I like the one with the stupid John Mellencamp in it. you know, but I love her rendition of Jewel's Who Will Save Your Soul. Probably my favorite. I'm going to take my phone off silent just so I can make that my ringtone.
Yeah.
Another pulse, another pulse, another pulse. It's just a lot of that. On a false way, I'm a new one. Yeah.
I'm enjoying this.
Yeah.
Your impression of this.
Two performances in one day of that song. Two? As we end this episode, Justin, I want to ask you two questions.
Okay.
Who is the true teen pop princess, in your opinion?
I think without a doubt it's Britney.
Yeah. I would agree with that.
Yeah.
I would agree with that. Who is your favorite? Now, that could be a lot of things. That could be, like, doesn't mean that's your favorite musician. Maybe you like their acting or their rendition of Jewel songs or their Dirty Eras.
I think my favorite is also Britney.
Yeah?
Yeah. I mean, here's the thing. Most of this music is not my thing. Mm-hmm. And I've never heard any of the four of them have a song as good as Toxic. So even just as musicians...
I mean,
right there, I don't know of any other song by any of them that's better than that one. So, right there, yeah. Britney wins it.
Yeah.
Plus, I mean, now, Jesus, I was 14 years old. I love Britney Spears. You kidding me?
Yeah. And that's what I think is so funny, because it was like, you know, straight girls and gay guys wanted to be her.
Mm-hmm.
And then straight guys and gay girls wanted to be with her.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone loved her.
Yeah.
Everyone. Which is, it was just like, everyone was obsessed with her. And, you know, we talked about this a little bit this afternoon of you know, because I'm looking at this stuff and I'm like, Jesus Christ, what a workhorse. Like, I mean, all of them, but like the amount of shit that happened with her between 1999 and the end of 2003, like how much she did, how many songs she had, just like, and there's stuff I didn't even mention. It's just like, it's no wonder that she is kind of in the state that she's in right now, because this is like her entire life. And this started from like, mm-hmm. you know, before she was even in adolescence. And it's just, it's insane the amount of work that she's put in, to her career. And it's no wonder that she doesn't want to do any of it anymore because, yeah. you know, I mean, for years, I know she enjoyed it, but then for years she was forced to do it. So, you know, I can really understand. And I mean, that shit is work.
Oh yeah.
And yeah, I mean, I hope that she gets the help that she needs, and I hope that she continues, you know, and is happy and healthy, whether she never records another song ever again. But she has left like such a legacy with her music that's just like, I feel like it's unrivaled.
Yeah. I mean, Britney especially, I feel like is, yeah. I mean, when you talk about like, if you were going to say a short list of like the greatest pop stars of all time, you know, it's, I mean, oh, you'd yeah. have to include her, you know, you'd say Madonna yeah. and you'd say Michael Jackson,
mm-hmm.
maybe Prince,
yep.
You yeah. know, you would have to include yeah. Britney. I mean,
yeah. I mean, her discography is just. It's insane. It's insane how many albums she's made in the last, you know, 20 years.
Yeah.
Or, you know, 25 years or whatever. Yeah, it's crazy. Now, I do want to... one last thing. So I lied. I had three questions.
Oh, okay.
What... And maybe because you weren't listening to the music at the time, like, is there another pop star of this era that you like? That you enjoy? Who was not in the running to be... the teen pop princess of 1999.
But like still like a female solo artist?
Yeah, like a female solo artist, kind of the late 90s, early 2000s.
How about Vitamin C? I like that one song.
That Graduation song?
Yeah, I'll choose her. I'll do that one.
Isn't that just Baz Luhrmann talking? Or is that's the same that's song? The sunscreen, that's sunscreen song? Are those different songs?
Yes.
Oh,
very
okay.
different.
But isn't Vitamin C in that song or something?
I don't know. I never knew there was a connection between those two things.
You know what? Maybe there's not. is so Vitamin C, that's what you're going with?
That's the only one I could think of.
Not Jennifer Lopez?
Oh, well, okay.
Listen.
Yeah.
J-Lo's music several, in the late several 90s other awakenings, 2000s.
Several other awakenings. I was never an Avril Lavigne guy. I don't like the faux poppy punk thing.
Yeah.
Listen,
I didn't care for
Ashley Simpson either when she tried to do it.
Oh, God. Her little jig.
Her little SNL jig.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I mean, God, I guess it's got to be J-Lo, right? She was like a hit machine. And
yeah. Oh, my God. I mean, her, truly, like, J-Lo's early stuff is some of my favorite pop music ever.
Mm-hmm.
I really, genuinely, they're all bangers. She's got so many good songs.
Yeah.
In fact, on the way home today.
I like that I thought of Vitamin C before I thought of I don't put J-Lo in the like teen pop category though. I mean,
well, that's the thing, is she wasn't a teen.
Right. That's so I don't think of her in that same that same group. Like she was her own, yeah. She's her own genre yeah. of pop kind of.
She was already a grown ass woman.
She's a grown ass yeah. woman.
She a grown ass woman. And she's still a grown-ass woman, and she looks great. Happy for her. You know?
Yes, yes.
Bennifer 2.0. We got to wrap this up, because I'm going on too long talking about J-Lo, who is actually not the subject of this episode. Justin. Plugs.
Plugs?
Plug us up. plug us up and plug us out.
Cut that.
I will not. I'm going to leave it in.
Oh, so, yeah, you can find this show wherever you found this show. Spotify, Apple Podcasts.
That's a Great. That was a great word.
Thank you. hey, leave us a review. Go on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, whatever. Leave us a review if you like the show. Hit us up on social media. We are most active on Instagram at Cool Kids Club Pod. You can find us on Twitter at the same handle. You can find us on Facebook if you just search for Cool Kids Club Podcast.
Yes, you can.
Yeah, where can the people find you, Amy, if they want to follow you personally and see pictures of your cats?
Well, you can find me on Instagram at Amy Reads, TNAIMEE. Yeah, mostly just pictures of my cats and places I travel to.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty much it. Justin, where can the good people find you personally on Instagram?
I am at Lousy with Ghosts on Instagram. I don't post too often, but I'm always lurking. I'm always creeping.
We're always creeping.
I'm lurking. I'm judging. And I'm usually it's pictures of cats. It's pictures of, you know, toys that I've bought or movies that I've picked up or something.
We're good about posting in our stories things we find funny.
Yeah.
Promoting Cool Kids Club, things like
that. Oh, sure. Of course, thank you, as always, to Brian Hey Guys Wakefield for our theme song. Check him out at brianwakefieldmusic.com. Amy?
Yeah. Justin?
Amy?
Uh-huh.
Well, we're back to this, and we're sounding very rich and very smooth.
We're sounding very rich. Very smooth.
Very smooth on the microphone tonight. I think that probably what everyone should do until the next episode is, well, just stay cool.
Why don't you go on and just stay cool?
Real cool. Bye.